This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Modern psychology tells us that it is all within us. It is about human behavior. It doesn't have anything much to do with what comes from the outside, except for the lives that we live in the material world. Susan Martinez says we are spirits housed in a body. And just as houses can be haunted, so can people. When the living succumb to dissociative states of consciousness, they become a magnet for lost but clinging spirits known as djinn, dibbuk, daemon, wukabi, or simply the undead. They hover unseen on the earth plane, ready to inhabit the most suitable body available. Hello, Susan Martinez, and welcome to Dreamland.
Hi, Whitley. I'm so glad to be back.
Well, good. Just for those of you who don't remember Susan's last visit to the show, she's a writer, linguist, teacher. She is also a paranormal researcher of the first class. She has a doctorate in anthropology from Columbia University. She's the author of a number of books, including The Time of the Quickening, but also now, Field Guide to the Spirit World, The Science of Angel Power, Demonic Disincarnate Entities, and Demonic Spirits. And there is a foreword by Whitley Strieber. So this time, for once, I have certainly read the book. No, the truth is I always read the books, and I think you guys know that from the fact that the interviews that go on Dreamland are generally a little bit deeper than what you will hear on most shows. Now, Susan, we've got a lot to talk about, and I want to start with the idea, the difference between what psychology says is happening and what you say is happening. If you could just give us a condensed idea of that.
Before we got started today, I was putting my mind on our topic, and I was trying to think, if just in case the some host asked me, what's the book about? You know, I was trying to think of a quick soundbite to describe it. And the first thing I came up with was an answer to today, the dead end of today's psychology. I start by saying that the word psychology comes from the word psyche, which is Greek for soul, and they don't even deal with it. In fact, it's excluded from the considerations in the science of psychology.
Yeah, it's gone. We no longer, and in fact, most people don't really in their heart of hearts believe in it, is existence. That's why we're so afraid of death. I think. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but that's my opinion.
No, you're not wrong. Death for the true spiritualist is something that we welcome. I mean, you know, in the old days when of grassroots spiritualism, they were calling it the real life. You know, the real activities in the beyond, in the spirit world. Whitley, I didn't plan it that way, but the book, you know, which was something that sort of, it was an imperative, it was something that had to be written, it was something I put off for years, the book, I did not plan it that way, but the primary focus, I would have to say, is on the shortcomings of psychology and the way we regard the human psyche, the way we have put everything on the brain and forgotten all about the spirit. So that leads to the second overall characteristic of my book, which is a deep critique of our materialist culture.
Yeah, and that's exactly right. The more material stuff we've got around us, the less we see of who we really are. We're losing ourselves in material.
Right, and It so happens that the book I'm writing now, on a completely different topic, but, you know, which is another one that I have to get off my chest, the book I'm writing now is more or less about the future, what to expect and what's coming. And it is my firm belief that we're coming into a new age of spiritualism.
Well, I hope so, because we certainly need something more. And one of the reasons I wrote a foreword to your book is that it explores the something more so very well. And tell us about the way the world looks to you. In other words, to a conventional scientist, the world looks pretty much like what you see, even though a lot of his work involves things you can't see. But he doesn't think about that. He thinks he believes in invisible particles, but he doesn't believe in anything about the human being that can't be seen. But you do. And what do you see around us, for example?
I'm a faithist. It's a sort of a religion. It's a spiritualist religion. And most of my associates in faithism are clairvoyant people like yourself. They can go into the spirit world and do things. I'm not in that category. I'm a different category. I'm a scholar, an intellectual, and a truth seeker, you know? So my job is to write the books, you know, to help people understand. Their job is more working in spirit, other kind of operations in the unseen. So I stand apart from my actual group because I'm not clairvoyant. I am intuitive, though, and that's worth something. What is the question I'm trying to answer right now?
Well, what we were trying to starting to talk about was what I was thinking we would talk about would be the fact that you see the world as being filled with spirits as well as physical beings.
Oh yeah.
And tell us a little bit about some of those spirits.
Okay. To advance this study, you have to really get outside of our own culture, which is, as I mentioned before, is so materialist, and get into the other cultures of the world, particularly the third world, and also cultures of the past, pre-industrial people. Let's say you go to a place like Morocco. Those people are really, you could almost say, obsessed with jinn. That's typically spelled J-I-N-N. And those are the spirits that can inhabit a house and kind of take over. I'm aware of the panic that people feel in Morocco over the jinn and the things that they do to prevent them from taking over their households. But this is not just Morocco. In India, they would be called the Pisaka, and those are spirits as well. There are places in Southeast Asia and in the Pacific where it's totally traditional for the people to be aware of the spirits, which are nothing other than the souls of their departed relatives. And they do not take very kindly to them when they roam upon the earth rather than go travel onward and beyond, continuing the outward journey. They, too, are very conscious of their ability to obsess and possess the minds of the living.
Now, when you say possess the minds of the living, what happens to the living when they achieve their objective?
When you say they, do you mean the spirits?
Yeah, when somebody, you say, try to possess the minds of the living.
Okay.
And a lot of your book is about that.
Right, right. It turns out that this book was, in a way, an answer to a big part of what the New Age is producing, where whenever they use the word spirit or spiritualism or spirituality, it always means something lofty and wonderful and mysterious and grand. Now, the truth of the spirit world is that it has the dark and the light sides, just the same as in our known world. It has the dark and the light. The New Age put so much emphasis on the light side of spirit and totally ignoring the negative stuff that really I had to write a book that explained what happens when the negative side of spirit gets into your life.
Well, I know people in the New Age movement who, if you start to talk about anything like that, they will immediately just run. They don't even want to hear it.
Well, I'm glad you said that, because something I've becoming very conscious of lately, just lately, since I wrote the book, is cognitive dissonance. I feel that we're moving very rapidly toward the changeover, which is, my futuristic thoughts.
Right.
They change it.
Oh, yeah, we are, definitely.
And that being on the cusp of the old paradigm and the new one, we're caught in a very dramatic cognitive dissonance. And translating that into the conversation we're having right now means to say that people are aware of the spirit life, but they're denying it. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, the cognitive dissonance.
And if they're not denying it, then they're denying a big part of it by saying, "Oh well, you know, I'm not interested. There's no dark side to this. This is all sweetness and light." Or there are religious people who are obsessed with the dark side and always think only about the demonic. So, you know, we got to find a happy medium. It's like any coin; it's got two sides.
In order to master ourselves and master life, we need to understand both sides, the dark and the light.
Well, exactly.
We need to understand it. Don't mean we're going with the dark to expound on it. It don't mean we're going there. It means we're mastering life by understanding both sides of it. I have found that most dramatic examples that I could find in human psychology center around the disorder known as multiple personality disorder. We call it MPD for short.
Right.
A couple of decades ago, they decided to change the name to dissociative identity disorder, DID for
right.
short. Okay. I am here today to say that that is a typical cognitive dissonance for starts, but also a typical denial. Let me explain myself. The phrasing multiple personality disorder gives the very clear impression that you're talking about more than one person or more than one personality inside a single person. When you switch it to DID, dissociative identity disorder, it's you can't tell what they mean. It's a typical intentional ambiguity, intentional obscuration, intentional denying the impression of the original title.
Why is this? What's going on? You know, we come to a break. We're going to take a little break here, folks. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Did you know that you can go to a website called Strieber.com, that's Strieber.com, and get all kinds of Whitley Strieber books from the newest to the oldest? Majestic is there, Transformation, Breakthrough, all kinds of cool books, and most of them, the ebooks, are like $3.99. So go to Strieber.com and explore a little bit. There's an awful lot there that you're not going to find in many other places in this world. We're talking to Susan Martinez. Her new book is Field Guide to the Spirit World, The Science of Angel Power, Disincarnate Entities, and Demonic Possession. We were talking before we left the air about multiple personality disorder, something that I actually have and a lot of close encounter witnesses have. That's how missing time works, is that people are moved into another personality that doesn't have any access to the outside world. And in that personality, they have an entirely different information set about the close encounter experience, their experiences of life, and the world around them. But you were talking about why it had been changed from multiple personality disorder to dissociative identity disorder, which doesn't mean anything.
Right.
And it's a way of a kind of hiding from it, isn't it?
Perfect. Perfect.
Yeah. So now, when a person, and a lot of your listeners on this show probably have it just like I do. I believe you referenced Kenneth Ring's work a couple of times in your book. And of course, his study of close encounter witnesses showed that one of the few consistent things about them was that they had childhood trauma. And if I'm right, that's what induces this in the first place, isn't it?
Absolutely. That's the other part of the book that is trying to blow up the bonds that prevent us from understanding and getting back to early life with its hidden scenarios that have caused the spirit, the native spirit, to rush away and cause exterior spirits to come in, and that's trauma. In some of the most critical cases, it started at birth. It started at birth trauma. I've got another book I wrote, which is kind of, I'm self-publishing it at the moment because I haven't found a publisher for it, but it's about school shooting. It's about school shooters. It's analyzing their minds and their motivations, and it's really very similar to the Field Guide book that we're talking about, because almost every one of these boys is a trauma victim from early life, and being as such, the scenario runs something like the following. We're talking about either an accident that caused a physical pain and suffering or injury, or we're talking about high fever where the child came close to death, or we're talking about family abuse. We're talking about very severe trauma in early life, almost always very early life, where you're totally vulnerable. Okay, there's a thing known as the fight or flight syndrome, and since you can't fight the enemy that's gotten to you, It's you choose flight. Spirit chooses flight to fly away from the traumatic scene. And that truly means the spirit rushing out of the body.
Right.
Yeah. Normally, it can rush back when the danger is past. But when this is chronic in early life, what happens is that the young person becomes an empty vehicle from that flight. It becomes an empty vehicle, and that attracts vagrant spirits, spirits who are on the earth plane, who have not moved ahead into the light, that are still in the darkness of the earth, and that were themselves traumatized in life. You know, this whole thing is a vicious circle.
It's a place of hurt, really, this level.
Oh, of course.
And,
absolutely.
Yeah. You know, I remember, I have, strange thing about me as a host is that I usually have a lot of experiences that kind of go with the people I talk to. And I sort of do that on purpose. And in this particular case, I was badly traumatized as a little boy, but intentionally in order to induce this multiple personality split. But you mentioned, the soul actually going out of the body during these moments of trauma. And I can remember lying in the lap of a man. His body is completely covered in black. I can't recognize him. It's just black. But I am looking down on this as this man is beating the dickens out of me.
Oh, my God.
And it's a horrible memory. And it came to me very suddenly one day at the Chautauqua Institute while Ann and I were sitting and chatting with a very intuitive psychologist and her husband, who were friends. I mean, I wasn't being treated or anything. And she suddenly said, "You know, Whitley, there's something about you besides the visitors and all of that other stuff. I think you had very traumatic things happen to you in your childhood that you don't remember." And that was one of the first things that led me gradually to remembering all of the things that had been done to me as a child.
Mm.
Now, we live in a world where as you just said, when that happens, when there's trauma and the soul literally leaves the body's then an open door, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, wait. You know, I shouldn't have said, isn't it? Because I'm looking at the clock, and we're going to take our second and little break here. Then we'll go on. We'll be right back.
Okay.
The Afterlife Revolution is getting great reviews. There's a tremendous, lovely response to it, and I'm so pleased and humbled because it's an effort on the part of myself and Ann. And I love Ann so much. I want her to succeed in this incredible task that she has undertaken of returning and communicating across the bridge between the worlds. And she's really doing it. This is a real thing that's happening. Listen to some of these reviews. Ann and Whitley Strieber lay out their life's work in the most exquisitely beautiful manner. This moving book comes from the heart, the unified heart of two people who have dedicated their lives in this realm and the next to revealing the nature of consciousness as it makes its sojourn in this human form. That's just one. Here's another. I love, love this book. It's a wonderful read, especially if you lost somebody very close to you. Just incredible. Here's another one. The book shows you how to grow your soul, for lack of a better term. Through Anne's insight, Whitley shares invaluable information that could only be from the other side. So take it seriously. Go to Amazon and get Afterlife Revolution. Go on to Amazon and get the Afterlife Revolution in paperback or in Kindle format. And if you have questions or thoughts, write me at whitley@strieber.com. I'm right here. I'm ready to answer anything you ask to help you in any way I can, always.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a three-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
We're talking to Susan Martinez, field guide to the spirit world, the science of angel power, disincarnate entities, and demonic possession. Now, when a soul is literally driven out of its body by trauma, and especially I think among children, because they are much more able to move back and forth than adults who have been taught for so many years that that's impossible.
Oh, that's right.
So what then, can something actually get in there and get into the body?
Yes, it's just as if it's a perfect analogy to leaving a door open. You yourself used the metaphor of a door a few minutes ago, and it's a perfect analogy. It's like an open door, and spirit is looking for opportunities. And when I say spirit, I'm talking about the loose cannons in the lower heavens. The normal thing for spirit to do is to move on, and there's a constant graduation to higher spheres of light and intelligence. But some spirits are incapable of even getting into the first resurrection, and they're just in the earth plane and looking for a place to experience life again.
Yeah, exactly. They want to live again, to as if, you know, they didn't get enough the last time, or they made mistakes and now they want to somehow or another come back, but they bring their mistakes with them, don't they?
Yes. The way to undo our mistakes is to move on into further light, and the higher you get and the more competent you get, the more you just become a helper for those below.
Now, what happens when, say, a child is traumatized, leaves his body, and someone else gets in? What then is that child like? Will the child's original soul not be able to get back, or what happens?
When you read, I really only know about this from a case study that I have read, but as an extension, I begin to see it in the real world, you know, the people I know, and ever since I became aware of a multiple personality, I can see it now. For example, you know, I can see it, Whitley, for example, in a friend, let's say a friend who gets a disease, comes down with some kind of illness, and then goes into remission. This happened with a friend of mine in the last couple of years, and I noticed this, and I started to meditate on it, and I realized, hey, the remission is about the altar coming in and taking over that body and living that life. In the literature, the incoming spirit is called an altar, the multiple.
Yeah.
The new personality is called an altar. So,
right.
I'll just use that terminology. So I began to realize that when people have illness, but then suddenly they're better, or they're in remission, all this mystery, all these medical mysteries have to do with alternating personalities.
Yeah. Yeah, well, they do, and I think they do anyway. But having lived with this, and you know, what happened to me as a child was that this became so overwhelming when I was 7. The trauma that I was experiencing in this class that I was being sent to at an Air Force base in San Antonio, there was nothing to do with the Air Force, I can assure you. my immune system collapsed, and I had to be put in isolation ward in a military hospital.
Oh.
And so I know how intense it can be. And, you know, I'm not the only – I don't know too many close encounter witnesses who, if you ask them, don't turn out to have pretty traumatic childhoods. And
of course.
What's interesting to me is, what is this a close encounter with? Our kind of assumption is it's with aliens because we see UFOs and we wake up inside what appear to be UFOs and so on and so forth. But could it be something else, Susan?
Oh, I think you're right. I've been wondering about that myself because I got through reading William Lyon's books. Do you know who I'm talking about?
I do not.
It's spelled L-Y-N-E, and he's based in New Mexico, and I really, really found out what's going on with the extraterrestrial business from reading his books. Let me say this. Let me get sidetracked for a second and say this. I believe there are two phenomena that answer all these questions. One of them is man-made airships, you know, that are part of secret government projects. So the governments do not want us to know about them. And they did get started in the early part of the 20th century, and things really got hot around the time of World War II. But, okay, that's the one thing. And the other kind of starship, the other kind of UFO are a genuine spiritual convoys, the Aetherians who know how to build fire ships and who do occasionally stop by the Earth in their fire ships. And only intuitive and clairvoyant people are capable of seeing them. I don't think there's anything else. I don't think they're the extraterrestrial in William Lyon's books are very, very carefully documented as government hoaxes. The government wants us to continue the idea of ETs coming here because it's a cover up for the secret projects of their own.
Well, it goes even deeper than that, frankly. There is another universe involved in all of this, and there is a connection between the two, which, if it was opened, if the general public knew about it and understood it, then that door would be opened and it can never be closed again, and the people who now control this world would no longer be able to control it, because the average individual would be profoundly empowered in a lot of new ways. At least that's what I think would happen.
Yeah.
Now, we're going to take another final and last break.
Okay.
Free Dreamlanders, enjoy these reminders.
Did you know that the Unknown Country newsletter is absolutely free and comes to you by email once a week? The newsletter has been published since 2000, and in all that time, not one subscriber has ever received a single piece of spam, because they were on our list. But what they have received, week in and week out, is the very latest from UnknownCountry.com, including a Dreamland preview and all the latest news. Go to UnknownCountry.com and sign up today. You owe it to yourself, and it's free.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
We're talking to Susan Martinez, field guide to the spirit world, with a forward by yours truly, Whitley Strieber, there is a chapter that I found fascinating called Soul Murder. Can you tell us a little bit? Then you begin to get into this, in the book, into what is happening to people who are being beaten up by this stuff. And it's kind of ugly. It's not pleasant. A lot of them are like criminals and so forth. So can you tell us what soul murder is?
It's the result of what we were talking about earlier, when the parent or the caregiver or whoever's raising the child denies them what they need in order to grow normally and happily. The child needs encouragement, the child needs love, and the child needs approval and security. There are many households that fail in one or several or all of these aspects, and the result can be what I call a non-person. And non-person is also the Russian word for a sociopath.
So and you say in the book, we're talking about Scott Peterson. First, tell us who Scott Peterson was.
Oh, that was back in the 90s where he killed his pregnant wife because just out of a selfish, instead of like the mother, the girl's mother said, Lacey said, didn't you ever hear of divorce? He killed the wife and tried to cover up the crime, and he was found out. It became a really sensational case that anybody in our age group would probably remember the name.
Yeah, well, I know, but I've got listeners in all kinds of age groups. So,
okay, you see,
there's a quote in the book from one of the studies of Scott Peterson.
Yes.
Quote: "There are myriad and subtle ways a mother can tell her son that he must cease to exist as a person, that his true self must essentially disappear."
Yeah. Keith Ablo is a psychiatrist who did that study, and he really did a really great job because he walked beyond psychiatry to discover that Scott was made into a non-person by his family life. And not only that, he went back into family history, and he found this was going on for at least three generations.
You know, what fascinates me about this is that it's almost like a kind of curse. In other words, there are a lot of, if we assume that the cosmology that you've developed in your mind is a true one, and I think that there's reason to believe, at least to a degree it is, that there are lots and lots of dissatisfied, unhappy spirits out there that have kind of been generated by families like that. In other words, somebody lives in a family like that, they die, and they end up wandering in this plane in a very unhappy state, and they look for victims.
Right.
Is that good way of looking at it, do you think?
Yeah, that's exactly how traditional culture looks at it. They understand. I'm talking about, you know, pre-industrial society.
Right, right. When we could still sense our souls.
Yeah, they know this. They know this, that the deceased relative, if they went off in a bad state of mind, it's going to come back on them. And they're very conscious of these things. And pre-industrial society has always known about this. It's us who don't know about it.
And there's also the thought that, you know, that I learned an interesting thing from my relationship to the visitors, as I call them, and I don't honestly know what they are. I just know they're in my life and a very big, important part of my life, and I wouldn't say a bad one at all. In any case, I've found that they came to the United States for, and to a lesser extent, Canada and Australia, not simply because there are fewer people there, because there is trauma buried in people. And in the countries where there's been terrible war or a lot of suffering, like in Africa or war like in Europe, this trauma is in their DNA. And the visitors didn't want that. They wanted something that was purer and cleaner and basically happier. And I wonder if that's not true. That, I mean, if you go to a place like Germany or Russia, there are generations and generations of people who have lived in and been through hell. And those spirits, a lot of those spirits must be around. Like, what happened to the SS officers, for God's sakes?
Yeah.
They must be wandering the world.
That's right.
It's a creepy idea.
Remember I told you in an email that the timing for our conversation coincided with some spiritual work that the faithists were doing because it's the equinox right now?
Yeah.
And that's the work they're doing, Whitley. They have particular powers to work with the spirit world in cleansing all that heaviness that's there in order to make room for the new paradigm, for the light. We're coming into the light.
Yeah, and that's one of the big reasons you're on the show, because, you know, we're coming into a situation where things are going to be different in the sense that these discoveries of the existence of this level of reality is about light shining on it.
Oh, yeah.
That was one of the reasons I'd made the forward to your book, because I thought that was important. I thought to myself, there is light in this. Light is shining on this, and my life is about helping to turn on that light.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's why the spirits are competing for control of you, because you are so well situated to lead the way there, and they're competing. That's why you have the whatever confusion there is about who these visitors are.
Well, I don't have any. I just don't know who they are, and it doesn't bother me.
Oh, okay, good.
You know, I don't care, and basically nobody can control me. I can assure you of that.
Right.
The only person who could control me was Anne, and she did it by hitting me in the head with a book every once in a while.
Okay.
So, I played a great joke on her. We were walking home, and we lived right in Brooklyn, right on New York Harbor at the time, and it was July the 4th, and the fireworks display was going on. And she said, "What in the world is that fireworks display?" And I realized she had forgotten it was July the 4th.
Oh.
And so I said, "It's Wisconsin Cheese Week." And she said, "Wisconsin Cheese Week? Why in the world would they spend all of that money on fireworks to promote Wisconsin cheese? I don't even like it very much." I said, "Well, other people do." She said, "Well, it's not the best cheese in the world, that's for sure." And, you know, it's true. It's not like French cheese. So we went on in the house, and, you know, nothing further was said. And a few days later, we were at the house of some friends, a famous writer. And she pipes up with, "You know, did you all notice that fireworks display over the weekend for Wisconsin Cheese Week? Isn't that the stupidest thing you ever saw?" And the writer, his wife, looks at him, at her kind of confused and says, "And I thought, wasn't the 4th of July this weekend?"
Right.
And he wrote big, thick books, and suddenly, wham, I get hit in the head with a book. So that's how she controlled me. And I don't think that any spirits have done any better.
Oh, okay. I get that completely.
Yeah. I'm not possessed, believe me, except by me.
Right.
So, now, let's go on with this business, though, because a lot of people, according to your theory, do get possessed and do become very evil. They act out these evil deeds in the world. And why do spirits want to do this? That's another question I think you have a lot of very good answers to in the book.
These spirits who are in the lower plane in the first place are full of unresolved issues themselves. they can't move on, which is what they're destined to do. They're going to move on eventually, but they're stuck. They're stuck like molasses. And they haven't worked out their own problems. And like I said, we're all, you know, head cases here on Earth.
Sure are.
Yeah, so we can't expect any more of them. It's just that the higher spirits are working to lift them up and get them into hospitals and schools, and eventually that's where how they're took care of.
Yeah.
Okay. These revelations say that we make a big mistake when we take prisoners and sentence them to death, because there is no death and they come back on us.
Yes.
So it's our own problems coming back on us in the final analysis.
Well, you know, you have this wonderful quote from the Ohapse in the book of Fraga Patti. Evil spirits are both yourselves and the dead, whom ye have slain, death penalty, still live to torment you in spirit. Though their bodies be dead, they obsess you to deeds of wickedness.
So there's your answer.
Yeah. I wonder about that in some respects, because don't some people like who are executed die in a state of remorse? They realize they've made a mistake, and so when those spirits are freed from their bodies, I wouldn't think that they would become vengeant.
I don't know about this remorse. I'm not familiar with that. Anybody who's has their life took from them is not in a state of remorse, but of extreme agitation.
In other words, you're saying that people who are executed can't accept that.
Right.
Even if they maybe accepted it while they were alive, once they're dead and the soul is free, it has a different attitude.
No. Our attitude stays the same.
Do you have any stories that come to mind of, because there are a lot in the book, but any that you would particularly like to tell about the people who have been apparently entered by other spirits and taken over and are beginning to act in ways that are just wildly different from what they had been before?
All I can think of when you say that is a friend of mine, someone I was very friendly with, and I live in a small town, and there are really very few of our type of people here. I'm in the foothills of the Smoky Mountains up in North Georgia. It's a small town. I like it here because it's country. But what's missing is, you know, the intellectual stimulation and stuff like that. A friend of mine who. Who's like me, you know, from elsewhere, from the city, had my kind of experiences. We were very friendly for a long time, and he's gay. He's a gay guy. He broke up our friendship without any reason at all. And he done it twice. I had to give it some clear thought, you know, to get over the bad feeling of it. And I did come to the conclusion that it's a multiple personality there, and that one of them took over, that whoever took over don't know me and isn't my friend.
Yeah, so this is a person who is apparently, the door is open. What about people who can't be taken over? What are they like? Why can't they be?
This is not really true. We're all subject to a spirit influence. And even the ones who are, even the people who are better set up and more wholesome in character and of solid mind are open to influence of the higher sort.
Yeah, well, I think I'm an example of that, because I have a wonderful relationship with the beings that are in my life, and they are here. There's no question about that in my mind. The last time I had any kind of physical response from them was last night at about 3 o'clock in the morning, or this morning at about 3, which my listeners hear all the time because it happens all the time. And I got up and meditated like I always do, and I had a wonderful meditation. As always during the 3 a.m. meditation, wonderful ideas came into my mind for the book I'm working on.
Oh.
So, you know, it's great. I mean, I wouldn't trade it for the world. It got so much better after Annie passed away that I have a feeling that she might still be my editor.
Sure.
And I wouldn't be at all surprised. So, go ahead.
One of the most informative books on my bibliography was the one by Patty Duke, and she represents talent, all the Hollywood talent and all the creative kind of people, so very many of them, comedians, dancers, actresses, etc., are people who did get psyche opened traumatically in childhood and are open to artistic spirits, creative spirits, and that's how that works. It's fascinating. When you read the Patty Duke memoir, which is called A Brilliant Madness, you really can appreciate the mingling of abnormal, paranormal, and highly creative.
Yeah, and highly creative quite often, which is, you know, so some of these spirits that, I mean, I could conceive of welcoming some spirits into my body. Like Anne said after she passed away, she said, Whitley, you find out that bodies are community property. And which is an interesting way of looking at it. And I've sensed her presence with me every once in a while, like as if we shared the same body, which is very nice because, you know, I want to share my life with my wife very closely. I'm very glad that I ever even was aware of the possibility of an experience like that, frankly.
Yeah.
But you know, I've also, in my life, have had many encounters with people who have just died. And an example of a recent one, about a year ago, was a celebrity who died, a very famous man. And I wasn't really aware that he had died. And then suddenly, he was there. And he said, what am I doing with you? I thought I'd be met by Mother Teresa, not some nobody.
Oh, that's adorable.
Yeah. And I said, well, I'm your nobody, and the reason you're with me is because you think things like that.
Right.
And he eventually came to realize that he had done some things. He'd done some good things in this world, which was why he had this experience of a healing contact, like a contact with me at all. But then he came to face the fact that he had done some things in the world that were wrong and bad, and he could never undo them now that he was dead. He could not. He could never say to his children, I love you. He could never say to his former wife, I was wrong in what I did to you. And he began struggling with contemplating that. And he came back and forth a few times. And I always would try to say, to remind him, remember all of the wonderful things you did. That's why you have me. Take advantage of it, because I will take your mind and your memories into the good part of you. And you embrace that, and gradually I saw less and less of him, and he came to accept himself.
What I want to say is that first of all, Oaspe explains how the newly dead have particular power to return. So that's something that fades. In fact, you just said he wandered off eventually.
They do have power to return, but it does fade. And Annie's explained to me why.
Yeah. And the other thing I want to say is that, no, he can't take back what he did with the children or anything else that was a shortcoming of his in his life. But he can move on. And as we move on, the whole process involves getting stronger and wiser so that you can uplift those below you. And that's how the entire afterworld is structured.
Yes. And so he has, now he's got a chance to make what he can of what he has that's good. And,
right.
And that was the whole business of the, all the work I did with him was devoted to that so that he would move on and
exactly.
the people he hurt will move on too. And the people he helped will still experience the outcome of his helping hand.
Yeah, you know, what you said made me think of something because a little meditation that I was having just today, it concerned someone who did something that annoyed me. And I had contact with her today, and I was thinking in my mind how much better things would be if she could simply apologize. You know what I'm saying? People do not know how to give a genuine I'm sorry. People are full of phony I'm sorrys. But the real one, you know, which is just, hey, I'm sorry, I apologize, I was wrong, forgive me, okay? And it's all over once you spill that out like that. And that reminded me of what you were saying, what this guy said. You know, he really regretted that he had not said, I'm sorry, in this life. And he can teach that. He can teach that to others. And so he does have...
Yeah, of course he can. There's all kinds of things he can do. It's very important once you pass on, and don't forget this, folks, don't be frozen. You know, you've got a whole new life ahead of you. Believe me, it's true. And most of us are going to be coming out of a world where we didn't really believe that. And part of what's going to happen and is happening in the world is that this veil, or it's really more like a wall between the worlds, is lifting. And we're going to get into some really interesting experiences. And we're going to find, some of us are going to find, that the living are just as likely as the dead who are on a higher plane to be called on to help souls that are in trouble. And I found that out a long time ago when my grandmother died and I was in the church, and suddenly, to my amazement, these beautiful big balls of light came into the church and surrounded the coffin.
Really?
Yeah, and I thought, my God, I was very young at the time. I was about 28, I think, 30 maybe. And I didn't realize that nobody else in the church could see them. I almost shouted. I was so shocked. And then I realized, well, wait a minute, nobody else sees this. I must be crazy. But it was so obvious that they were alive. And the next thing I knew, they were communicating with me. And they said, she's still in her body. She doesn't believe she's dead.
Right, right, right.
Tell us about that. It happens, doesn't it?
It does. And that's another troublemaker. I've got a few passages in the book that explains that exact situation.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about it.
From when you come, when you leave the body and you end the material life that we've lived, and you still have, you don't change at all. You go into spirit as a consciousness with the same ideas and beliefs that you carried with you in your mortal life. If you are 90% of the population today, you believe that when you die, it's all over. You're annihilated.
Right. And okay, then it turns out you're not annihilated.
And you have your consciousness, so you don't believe you're dead.
Right. And exactly. And, a lot of them don't. I mean, a lot of them, she didn't believe she was dead. It took a long time to get her to come out of her body. Her mother had lived to the ripe old age of 106, and she was in her 80s, and she was absolutely certain she wouldn't live. She would live as long as her mother.
Yeah, and part of that was stubbornness.
Oh, yes, that more than part of it.
Stubbornness is one of the seven deadly sins.
Well, she eventually, it took 7 or 8 years of coming back and forth between the two of us. We were close in life, and it turned out after she died, we became even closer. Eventually, I figured out how to get her to realize that she was, in fact, dead. And when she finally turned around from the illusion that she was looking out of a beautiful house that she had built or wanted to build, and looked at me with this amazed expression on her face and very curious, her eyes suddenly slowly turned to gold. And poof, she was gone.
You know, that's so beautiful because yellow is in the spirit world, and gold is considered the highest color.
Yeah.
So she was enlightened. She was enlightened.
She became enlightened. She finally
went on.
Her grandson bothered her enough to where she figured, if unless I get enlightened, he's still going to be bothering me, so I'm going. Mm. Anyway. Susan Martinez, it's been great fun to be together again. Field Guide to the Spirit World, The Science of Angel Power, Disincarnate Entities, and Demonic Possession. Don't be afraid of thinking about our world differently and in a new and yet very old way, because this is just part of reality. You are not alone here. You are not just a body, and you have got a fascinating future ahead of you, you can be sure. Susan, thank you so much for spending some time with us on Dreamland.
Oh, that's just great. Thank you so much yourself.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.